Unemployment is through the roof. The COVID-19 pandemic is getting worse, and none of us is getting any younger. Yet, for some reason, ever since Wednesday, I have just been happy as can be. I feel great. I have a spring in my step. The days look bright to me. There's an upbeat song on my lips and in my heart. I hope you are singing too. Randy will light the chalice. At times, our own light goes out and is rekindled by a spark from another person. Each of us has cause to think with deep gratitude of those who have lit the flame within us and the community. Technical difficulties, but. Before we sing the first hymn, let me remind you to leave yourselves muted. However, we want you and whoever is with you to sing with Mary as big and loud as you like. Make it a joyous experience. So let's all sing the opening hymn, When I'm Frightened, number 1012.
When I am frightened, will you reassure me? When I am uncertain, will you hold my hand? Will you be strong for me? Sing to me quietly. Will you share some of your stories with me? If you will show me compassion, then I may learn to care as you do. Then I may learn to care. When I am angry, will you still embrace me? When I am thoughtless, will you understand? Will you believe in me? Stand by me willingly. Will you share some of your questions with me? If you will show me acceptance, then I may learn to give as you do. Then I may learn to give. When I am troubled, will you listen to me? When I am lonely, will you be my friend? Will you be there for me? Comfort me tenderly. Will you share some of your feelings with me? If you will show me commitment, then I may learn to love as you do. Then I may learn to love.
Thank you, Mary. Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Community of Cambria. We are glad you have joined us today. As a Unitarian Universalist community, we celebrate religious diversity and welcome all who journey in search of faith and spirituality. The UUCC is a lay-led congregation inviting speakers from different religious traditions and spiritual or scientific backgrounds to speak at our pulpit. We encourage presentations covering a variety of topics and areas of interest to our community that connect with the UU Seven Principles. Today's service centers around the third principle, acceptance of one another and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations. Spiritual growth isn't about a vertical ascent to heaven, but about growth in every dimension at once. It's spirituality in 3D. Growth in spirit doesn't measure one's proximity to a God above, but rather the spaciousness of one's own soul, its volume, its capacity, its size. My name is Nancy Tolan, and I'm your worship associate this morning. I would like to extend a special welcome to today's guests and visitors. We're glad you joined us this morning under these trying circumstances. If you are a guest and would like to introduce yourself, please raise your Zoom hand and unmute yourself when Diane calls your name.
All right, no guests or visitors today. Back to you, Nancy.
Well, and welcome to any guests or visitors who do not choose to identify themselves as such. Oops. If you are not on our mailing list, please visit our website at www.uuccambria.org so we can keep you informed about all of our activities. And please check out What's Happening, a weekly e-blast sent to all of our members and friends. This is a great way to keep up with the latest news in our community. And as a reminder, if you wish to see this or any of our past Zoom services again, recordings of these services are available on the UUCC website and on Facebook as well. The membership committee invites non-members to consider becoming a member of our community. Please contact Janet Cooper or a board member if you are interested. Thank you. So again, good morning and welcome to everyone. Let us now recite the affirmation. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its prayer. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in freedom, and to help one another. We set aside this time for any short announcements that would be of interest to our UU community, members, and friends. Please keep your items short and to the point. For any items that need more explanation, please call or email the person after the service to be respectful of everyone's time. If you have an announcement, please raise your Zoom hand by clicking on the raise hand button in the reactions icon. When Diane calls your name, please unmute yourself, then speak.
All right, does anyone in the sanctuary have an announcement?
Yes, ma'am. Andy. There will be a worship committee meeting tomorrow at 5 o'clock via Zoom. So all worship committee members, please check in at 5. And if anybody else is interested in joining the meeting tomorrow, please send me an email and I'll send you the link to the Zoom link for that meeting. Thank you. 5 o'clock tomorrow.
Thank you, Andy. And thank you, Randy. And Andy, I think you have an announcement too.
I do, actually a few. First off, a reminder that we're collecting art for the UUCC art show. Anybody who wants to photograph an example of their visual arts and send it to me by email, I'll put together a slideshow of all those works and we'll share them on Zoom in the future. Secondly, there's a forum coming up this Thursday at 7 p.m. via Zoom to discuss the UUA's proposed eighth principle of Unitarian Universalism. And I'll just read that quickly. The proposed eighth principle reads, "We, the member congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association, covenant to affirm and promote journeying toward spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and our institutions. So next Thursday at 7 p.m., we would like to meet to discuss that eighth principle and whether or not our congregation wants to adopt it. Thirdly, we're still collecting for the special Zoomification fund, which is outside of the annual budget, but needs additional money. So if anybody would like to contribute to the ever improving Zoom system that we use for these Sunday services and all our meetings, please send your checks to the UUCC as soon as possible. Thank you. And finally, board members, please remain online after the service today for a brief meeting for the board. Thanks, that's it.
Thank you, Andy. Janet Cooper, would you please unmute yourself and give us your announcement?
Hey, thank you, Diane. I'd just like to say this morning that it is Fourth Sunday, and this is our first collection of the new year for the San Luis Obispo Food Bank. The food bank, I know, is very grateful for all the support they've received over the past year from the community to keep their services available to everybody needing food. But we still have some hard days ahead, so please remember the food bank, and if you get a chance, make a donation to the Fourth Sunday collection today. Thank you.
Thank you, Janet. Dolores, would you please unmute yourself and tell us your announcement?
Yes. So the Goodwill donation drive is going well, and the sanctuary is filling up, and we'll probably have to call for a truck to come out and empty the church out because it's getting pretty full. But keep bringing stuff in, because that one truck is only $400, and we're anticipating to do a second truck. So get all your friends to bring all their stuff and clean out their houses. Okay, every Saturday from 11 to 1, you can bring your stuff. Thank you.
Thank you, Dolores. No more hands that I see at the moment, so I'll hand it back to you, Nancy.
Thank you, Diane, and everybody. Next week, Steve Schwalbe will present Killing for God Using Man-Made Religion. Sharing together some of our personal and significant joys and concerns brings us closer as a faith community. We invite you to share the milestones that are deeply felt as a part of your personal life. Please be mindful and considerate of all who come to worship with us this morning. This is a time of community building. Flames of these candles also embody all the joys and sorrows which may have gone unspoken this morning, but are also deeply felt in this community. The first reading is 180 Degrees by Federico Moramarco. Have you considered the possibility that everything you believe is wrong? Not merely a bit off, but totally wrong? Nothing like things as they really are? If you've done this, you know how durably fragile these phantoms we hold in our heads are. Those wisps of thought that people die and kill for, betray lovers for, give up long friendships for. If you have not done this, you probably don't understand this poem, or think it's not even a poem, but a bit of opaque nonsense, occupying too much of your day's time. So you probably should stop reading it here, now. But if you've arrived at this line, maybe, just maybe, you're open to that possibility. The possibility of being absolutely, completely wrong about everything that matters. How different the world seems then. Everyone who was your enemy is your friend. Everything you hated, you now love. And everything you love slips through your fingers like sand. Let us now join in a time of meditation, of prayer, and of silence. Let us seek the quiet and the calm, laying aside our struggles, and in the silence, may there be a reverence in our hearts, a thankfulness within our spirit, and a deepened understanding of the meaning of our lives. Let us enter the stillness. please come back now. The second reading is What I Believe by Jacqueline Woodson from Brown Girl Dreaming. I believe in God and evolution. I believe in the Bible and the Quran. I believe in Christmas and the New World. I believe there is good in each of us, no matter who we are or what we believe in. I believe in the words of my grandfather. I believe in the city and the South, the past and the present. I believe in Black people and white people coming together. I believe in nonviolence and power to the people. I believe in my little brother's pale skin and my own dark brown. I believe in my sister's brilliance and the Too Easy books I love to read. I believe in my mother on a bus and Black people refusing to ride. I believe in good friends and good food. I believe in Johnny Pumps and jump ropes, Malcolm and Martin, Buckeyes in Birmingham, writing and listening, bad words and good words. I believe in Brooklyn. I believe in one day and someday and this perfect moment called now. The anthem today is If We're Honest by Francesca Battistelli, Jeff Pardo, and Molly Reed, and will be sung by Jan Kalmner. Today's sermon is titled, When I Know I'm Right, to be delivered by Reverend Rod Richards. Reverend Rod Richards has served as minister of Unitarian Universalists San Luis Obispo since 2012. He is currently serving also as vice president of the UU Ministers Association. Rod is originally from the Midwest, born in South Dakota, growing up in Iowa, and entering adulthood in Minnesota. He served the congregation in Sierra Vista, Arizona for 9 years before coming to UU SLO. He is very pleased to be returning again as guest minister to UU Community of Cambria and is eager to find ways that our two congregations can effectively collaborate in bringing the good news of Unitarian Universalism to the wider community. Reverend Rod Richards.
Thank you. It is very good to be with you all. I appreciate this January tradition that has arisen of being able to visit your congregation, and I'm glad we were able to do it even in this unique year. A divided nation. That is what we call ourselves now. And indeed, the way that many outside this country now see us. A divided nation. It is the phrase you encounter in a variety of forms in the news, from the mouths of politicians, in the titles of articles and editorials and books. It's everywhere. A divided nation asks, "What's holding our country together?" reads the headline from US News and World Report. Foreign Affairs magazine offers some advice on how Biden can rebuild a divided and distrustful nation. Americans must get to know one another again. Healing a bitterly divided nation, the link between Lincoln in 1865 and Biden in 2021, from the Washington Post. President Biden highlighted this reality in his inaugural address, saying, "We must end this uncivil war that pits red against blue, rural versus urban, conservative versus liberal." Easier, as the saying goes, easier said than done. How do we bring unity when civil society feels so fractured? How do we bring healing in a climate that seems to promote inflicting pain and ignoring pain? How are we supposed to turn down the heat when passionate commitment is so necessary and when lives are at stake? Spoiler alert, this sermon holds no comprehensive, decisive solutions to those questions, but hopefully holds some helpful reflections as we all engage these questions together. I have great respect for the tradition here in your congregation to highlight one or more of the seven, presently seven, principles in each of your services. Thinking about what I wish to focus on in this service, the third principle seemed the closest and most natural match. And the third principle reads, beginning with the preamble, "We, the member congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association, covenant to affirm and promote agreement with one another and encouragement to spiritual growth that meets with our approval." No, that's not what it says. No, it doesn't. It says we covenant to affirm and promote acceptance of one another and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations. It doesn't say agreement. And it doesn't put restrictions on nor even attempt to define spiritual growth. But look, it does say acceptance. Isn't that a form of agreement? Well, technically, it affirms that we will accept one another. It does not say that we strive to accept all opinions, beliefs, perspectives, or actions. And therein lies possibly our first lesson. Accept one another. What does that mean? I have come to think that it's as simple and as difficult as this: to remain aware of the other person as a person. Now, that may sound absurd. What could the other person be but a person? Let me say that there are times when I find myself yelling at the TV, firing back at someone who has a viewpoint very different than mine, whose perspective I find hopelessly twisted, whose opinions and commitments I find dangerous. And I find myself talking back to the person on TV in a less than polite manner. And this can all sound vaguely humorous or hopelessly dysfunctional, but I'm guessing I'm not the only one who sometimes does this. But there are times when, in my anger and my outrage at the real danger that I believe is in their words, I realize that I have lost sight completely of the fact that the person speaking on my TV screen is a person. To me, in those moments, they are only a carrier of toxic opinions. To me, in those moments, they are but a symbol of things I find abhorrent. I have lost touch with that person's personhood. It's easy to do. And when I allow that to happen, I can justify responses that I would not be able to justify toward another actual person, because they become only a symbol of something I passionately oppose. We speak of red and blue, Democrat and Republican, urban and rural, liberal and conservative, socialist and capitalist, humanist and evangelical, on and on. It's not that those terms are not useful. They are descriptors of something about a person. But if that's all I have in order to define the person, then it's easy for the person to become the opinion in my mind, the symbol of a body of beliefs. And because I find the opinions or beliefs mistaken, misguided, even dangerous, or threatening to my deeply held values, I find myself in fighting the position the person takes to be willing to imagine crushing the person who has become only a symbol of that position. And I have had experiences, maybe you have too, where I first come to know a person and then find that our opinions differ considerably, sometimes frighteningly. Or I find Facebook posts from extended family and I'm shocked by their positions. It doesn't change my opinions about those matters, but it does mean that I cannot so quickly or unthinkingly disregard the person's humanity, their personhood, because I have known them first as people. It is a powerful thing to accept one another. It doesn't mean that I will be any less passionate in opposing ideas, opinions, policies, actions that are destructive to those principles we hold most dear. It does mean that I will not give up on your personhood, or by extension, my own personhood when we disagree. And if I accept you as a person, it means that I will be open to listening. It means that I will attempt to suspend my suspicion that I already know what you're going to say. It means that I will approach our conversation with a curious rather than a critical perspective, even when I am so sure that I am right, which necessarily means your opposing or simply alternative view is wrong. And to me, this is another lesson: to practice listening beyond or beneath opinions. Opinions are only the very thinnest surface sitting on top of the deep stories that we all carry. With opinions, I naturally can consider myself right, which means that unless you agree, you are wrong. But I can't be right about your story, nor can you be right about mine. Will you share your story with me, the song we sang this morning? Another hymn in our hymnal says, when we tell our story from deep inside and we listen with a loving mind and we hear our voices in each other's words, then our heart is in a holy place. Stories connect us in ways that abstract thought and opinion do not. And stories, I believe, have a stronger influence on our beliefs and values and opinions than reason or faith combined. The stories we tell ourselves, about our lives, has a lot to do with how we will respond to the world, to the very fact of our existence. And I don't mean to romanticize this. Sharing stories won't magically erase all the divisions between us. I may listen to your story and still reject your interpretation of your story, realizing, of course, that my interpretation of your story is coming from an outside perspective. More precisely, I may think that the conclusions you have drawn from your story have led to harmful beliefs that threaten others. But before I get too self-righteous, I have to remember that my interpretations of my own story have changed over time. I have to remember that though I feel confident in the beliefs I now hold, they have grown, changed, expanded over time, thanks to the compassionate acceptance of others and the way that other people have patiently participated in raising my awareness, both personally and in the wider culture. Have you considered the possibility that everything you believe is wrong? Asks poet Federico Marimarco. Not merely off a bit, but totally wrong. Nothing like things as they really are. I am surprised at how threatened I feel by that question, even after multiple readings. But it does open me up to remembering how my beliefs have changed over time and to the idea that there is always room for growth and for new awareness to bloom. It opens me up to the realization that this is just as true for other people. To hang on to the humanity of even those whose ideas I must faithfully oppose if I am to be faithful to the ideals that I hold. As I appreciated the grace which others bestowed upon my ignorance, and probably will continue to do so, I pray. While I have appreciated that grace that they bestowed on my stubbornness in times gone by, I must hold on to that possibility for others. And Nothing I've said should be heard as a call to back off on our work to create more love, more justice, more peace in this world. Nothing I've said is meant to decrease our commitment to anti-racism and collective liberation. Nothing I've said is meant to imply that maybe we, our religious communities, just shouldn't get involved in politics. The values we hold and the principles we affirm and promote as congregations necessarily have political ramifications. We may disagree on how they are actualized, but we cannot fail to do what we can to give them life. As I listen to the pleas for unity and for healing this divided nation, I believe that some are completely sincere, and others, I fear, are thinly disguised schemes to avoid principled challenge in favor of keeping the peace. No justice, no peace. I fear that the motivation in some cases, whether conscious or unconscious, is not to promote civil conversation, but to guarantee comfort to those for whom the status quo is working just fine. In the interest of civility and unity, we won't press too hard for changes. We won't cry out too loud for justice. And we know that's not acceptable. Acceptance of one another means I must listen especially closely to the stories of those on the margins. I must realize that I, white, male, hetero, cisgender, temporarily able-bodied, am insulated from the lived experiences of so many who find themselves on the margins. I don't get to, or I shouldn't get to, compromise the struggle for justice, inclusion, equity in the name of unity or healing. There is no chance to heal wounds that are not first acknowledged as wounds. And US history holds far too many compromises made to placate the dominant culture, to avoid the challenge of our own highest ideals as a country. I believe there is good in each of us, no matter who we are or what we believe in, writes Jacqueline Woodson. I believe that too. I also believe that just as we have the capability to be honest and compassionate with one another and with ourselves, we also have great powers to deceive ourselves, to justify the unjustifiable, to avoid challenges, to ignore or intentionally reject one another's humanity. Each of us, all of us, have those potentials. So I have to remember that everything I experience is filtered, not only through my story, but through my current interpretation of my story. This is not a problem unless I engage in the fantasy that my story is universal. I will practice listening, especially when I know I'm right, approaching conversations with curiosity rather than assumptions, listening for the stories rather than for the opinions. Though I may speak with bravest fire and have the gifts to all inspire, though I may win the verbal fight, though I may prove I'm always right, if I don't have love, my words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain. In the struggle for a more just society, I will never let go of the humanity of those whose ideas and actions I oppose, meaning that I will also be nurturing my own humanity. Humbly, faithfully, I will join with you, and I will join with others in working toward more love, more justice, more peace. So may it be. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Richards. Normally, at this time, we receive offerings from our congregants. However, due to the virtual format of this service, we invite you to make your offering in one of the methods shown on the slide. These methods are posted in the newsletter and on the UUCC website. Please keep in mind that our congregation is entirely self-governed by the democratic process. One of the privileges of our free church tradition is to provide all of the financial support for our many ministries from among ourselves. Generosity, therefore, is one of the spiritual values we recognize as central to our personal and our institutional well-being. You are invited to participate in the blessing of giving by sending us an offering. Thank you. Thank you, Jan, and our thanks for all the gifts given and received today for the work of this community. Let us now sing the doxology. Lead you through some Beatles wisdom. Please sing along, but also please keep your Zoom muted. Mary?
Oops, might help if I play the right chord.
You say yes, I say no. You say stop, I say go, go, go. Oh no, you say I say hi, you say low, you say why, and I say I don't know. Oh no, you say goodbye, and I say hello, hello, hello. I don't know why you say goodbye, I say hello. Why do you say goodbye? Goodbye. would you think if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song, and I'll try not to sing out of key. I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help.
Thank you, Mary. That was delightful. Let us now recite the valediction. Whoops. Oh, that's right. We extinguish the flame of this chalice, and we know that the light of truth and love and the warmth of this community go with us until we meet again. After the benediction, please click on the gallery view button in the upper right corner of your screen, but please remain muted. Diane will call on you when you raise your Zoom hand. Reverend Richards.
Thank you for this opportunity to be with you all today. And let us remember, though we are necessarily isolated from one another at the present time, we are not isolated beings, but connected in mystery and miracle to the universe, to our communities, and to one another. May we go listening deeply, speaking truthfully, and may all we do be done in love. So may it be.